I'm Robert Colello. You know, I started first dibble and dabbling in drugs when I was 14 years old, 8th grade. And in 12th grade, 11th grade, I went back to boarding school. Couldn't do it as much, but I was doing a lot more. I got into LSD and hallucinogens at that time. My 12th grade year, though, I got kicked out of that boarding school for using drugs. Failed a drug test in the very beginning of the year, and that's when it got out of control. I went through three high schools that year. I went to my first inpatient rehab, and went to my second outpatient rehab. And to back up in between my 11th grade and my 12th grade year, I got my first DUI. It was 1998. Got kicked out of my boarding school. So going back to my DUI, it was pretty much the beginning of the end of of the fun times of using and drinking, and it became a real problem. So I get out of my first rehab, and to be honest with you, the first rehab was kind of a country club. It was like a vacation. I felt like the relief of, this lifestyle I was living, my parents didn't like. I was kind of getting a second chance with them. The things the therapists were telling me, I wasn't so much agreeing with them. I was there for my parents, not myself. I didn't think I had that big of a problem. They wanted me to get away from my mom's side of the tracks, if you will, where all my friends were, and go live with my father. My father lived in a very affluent side of town. They thought it'd be better for me to live over there. And I just found the same friends over there. Their parents just made more money than the friends that I hung out with on the other side of the tracks. So I got kicked out of my second school that year as I got introduced to a 12-step program. And they told me at the time that when it hurts bad enough, you'll hit your knees and you'll call out to God. And I'd never hit my knees. I was grew up proper Italian Catholic. We hit our knees enough on Sundays. I didn't do it after I got out of church during the week for sure. When I had my next stint in college, and I relapsed now on drugs, and I'd missed 2 months of school, and my life was coming crashing down, and I just started crying. And I just felt overwhelmed. I felt like my life was just out of control. It wasn't like I thought I'd be at that age. As a kid, I thought I'd be in college, away from home, on my way to a career, and I was just ruining my life. And I hit my knees right then and there, and I called out to God. I said, God, I believe in you, and I know that you're the only thing that's gonna help me. And I felt this rush. I felt like the Father put his hand right on the top of my head, and I felt this rush of warm, tingly feeling come all over my body. And this, when it came over, the tears were gone. Just stopped flowing, and I got up, and I knew everything was gonna be okay. And I went to my father, and I told him, hey, I need help. I don't want you to send me away to another inpatient because I wasted your money the last time, and I wasted your money at the boarding school and all the things I've done, and I really want to get help this time. Just send me to an outpatient. And he realized that I really wanted it, so he sent me down to Miami Beach, Florida, and I went down there for an intense, 4-month program. So I go to this rehab in Miami Beach, Florida, and my life radically changes. From day one to day 100 and what, whatever, 4.5 months later, my willingness to accept the things I needed to change was there. My serenity, my turning my life over to God was there. My dependence on God was there. And I learned this new thing about a relationship with God that I never knew before. Growing up the way I did, God was kind of like a genie. If you prayed for enough people, poured his blood over enough people, Lord, pour your precious blood over Aunt Mary and Uncle Tom and blah, 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 then you could ask him for whatever you want, And at the same time, he didn't like when you did bad things. So it was like this judgmental thing. And I had never gone to confession, so I had all this guilt built up inside. So now it was like the first time that I had this release where I'd wake up in the morning, I'd hit my knees and say, Lord, get me through the day without drinking and using drugs. And I'd get through the day and I'd say, Lord, thank you so much for getting me through the day without drinking and drugging. And during the middle of the day, if there was a problem, I'd give it to him. And if there was a success, I'd give him praise. Nothing was mine to take ownership of. Therefore, I could give him my problems. And I liked that. It was awesome. It was a new relationship. I'm 6 months clean and sober, and I meet my wife. We got married, and she was about 3 months pregnant, and I relapsed. And I go in the bathroom and look at myself in the mirror, and the mirror's kind of moving. And I'm like, what did I do? I just gave away a year and a half of like clean time, sobriety, this new life I had started. And the beast that had been laying dormant for the last year and a half just awoke. And it was almost like there's nothing I could do. And I went on a 6-month run after. And I went and copped some drugs. And I got high. And then I just cried. And I said, I can't do this anymore. I just felt like the Lord was telling me, like, God said, just gotta stop. It's time. And I flushed him out of the toilet. I called my sponsor up, and I was in tears. I could barely even talk. I tell her, hey, I give her the good news. I'm not using drugs anymore. The bad news was she didn't even know I was using drugs in the first place. She was furious. And every right, you know, she had every right to be. I had betrayed the number one thing in a marriage, and that's called trust. And it's, I came from a divorced family, and I'm like, I'm doing exactly what my family happened to my family. My dad wasn't a drug addict, but my dad left my mom at a young age, and it devastated me. And the actions that I did would cause the same thing to happen. And I was like, oh my God, this can't be happening. My son deserves a chance to have a father and a mother in the same house. One of my coworkers mentioned a guy by the name of Bob Coy I had to check out. He was a pastor at a place called Calvary Chapel up in Fort Lauderdale, and he used to be a cokehead all the time. And we went, and I remember looking at my wife and saying, what the heck, this thing's huge. There's no statue of Mary. Where's the communion, you know, cups? Where's the water that you dip your fingers in when you come in? Where's the candles for purgatory? And where's the cross of Jesus, for crying out loud, with them on there, you know? So I didn't really feel too comfortable in this place called Calvary Chapel with this pastor who was young and had a goatee, and, you know, I was like, I think he was even wearing a suit with an open, no tie or something. I'm like, you know, I'm used to the priests. So I was like, so we stumbled on a few churches, and then we stumbled on Calvary Chapel Fort Lauderdale again. I remember he's the ex-cokehead. Maybe I'll go listen to him again. I could relate to something here. And it was amazing, because my ears were open. I literally didn't hear one word he said the first time I went there, and then the second time I went there, I was captivated. And I was really captivated by that little thing they did at the end called the altar call. You're going to hell in a handbasket if you don't know Jesus. That's what my little interpretation was. I was scared. I was like, whoa, hell. So I went up, and man, that was just like the third and most powerful spiritual experience of my life. I went up there, I got saved. I'm excited, and here comes my wife, grabs my arm, wants me to get me out of there as fast as possible. You know, she came from a born-again Christian family, and she didn't have a great experience, and she didn't want this. She's like, that's not what I wanted to marry. You know, oh my gosh, it's happening. Now I tell her, the Lord loved you so much that he brought me to him to bring you back to him, you know? And change started happening. It's what I started watching, who I started associating with, where I started hanging out, you know, and all these radical things started happening. I started spending more time with church. So now I'm going to the church for a little while. I'm saved. I'm borrowing one of the Bibles from the back, you know, and I'm actually opening it up. And I remember Pastor Bob Quinn. This has been one of the most profound and life-changing sermons I've ever heard to this day. Everything that I was, everything that I stood for, and everything I was going after in life, he addressed, and it just changed where I was heading in my life. And up until that point, my goal was very simple. A Ferrari 360 Modena drop top in a 10,000 square foot home on Golden Beach in Miami. That's what I wanted. That was my dream, to live on the ocean, have a bunch of money, and drive a Ferrari. And I left there, wanted to be a pastor. And then my wife rededicated her life to God. And now we're both on this mission to serve the Lord. We're both on this mission to, you know, let the Lord lead us and direct us. When I look back what my life was like at 18 years old, and I look and see what my life's like now in my 30s, and how much work has been done. I'm going on 11 years clean and sober. The first four, it was all about me and the program I was in. And the last seven has been about me and a relationship with Jesus Christ. If he could change my life the way he's changed my life, if he could bring me to a state like he did in California, bless my business, bless my family, do all these things that are just so supernatural, shouldn't have happened, then I don't have anything to worry about. You know, and I remember having it so secure, I thought, my little world I'd made in Florida, and not having an ounce of peace. But, you know, I deal with my life problems, but I don't even think about using drugs or drinking. It just doesn't even come across my radar. It's not even a solution, because I have the solution. His name's Jesus Christ.